Grady Lance.
Yes, sir.
Good evening. Welcome to the regular meeting of your Board of Commissioners. Tonight, we have our invocation given by Michael Kilgore from Burton Memorial Missionary Baptist Church. And after that, we'll ask everyone to remain standing if you're able, and we'll have Mark Richardson introduce the person delivering the Pledge of Allegiance. So I'll ask you, if able, please stand. Reverend, make your way.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for who you are, how you love us, how you show us grace and mercy in all instances, Lord, and how you died on the cross for us to have eternal life through your Son. And I just, you told us to pray for your kingdom to come, that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven, Lord. And so I just pray that you would give the commissioners wisdom and discernment, help them as they sit in a position, Lord, in the government, Lord, to honor and glorify you with the position that they have. And I just, I pray for your will to be done. And I ask this in Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
If you will, remain standing, Commissioner.
And I'm going to ask at this time if Nancy Woody would come up. Nancy is a member of the VFW Auxiliary and serves both Guilford and Rockingham County. So, Nancy, if you would all render the appropriate courtesy, and Nancy will lead us.
I pledge the allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Be seated. Thank you, Pastor Kilgore, and thank you, Ms. Woody. We appreciate that. With that, the next item on our agenda is recognition, and we'll ask Rodney Cates if you'll come forward. Lance, you want to give him the handheld mic?
Sure.
If he has a hand free.
Yeah.
All right, I want to start tonight by giving this recognition is for our fire marshal staff, but I'm going to start by giving Melissa just a bit of relief. I understand she's turned her office upside down for the last couple of weeks and looking for this plaque. Melissa, I've got it. You don't need to look anymore. I did not lie. Melissa texted me and she said, did I come in her office and get a plaque? I did not come in your office and get a plaque. I did know where it was. I did know how it disappeared, but I did not come in and get it. So I did not lie to you. 4 years ago, members of the Rockingham County Fire Chiefs Council created a Rockingham County chapter of the Firefighters Burn Children Fund. Every October and November, the chapter collects toys throughout the county, which are donated to the J.C. Burn Center at UNC Chapel Hill and to Atrium Health at Baptist Wake Forest. This is a collective effort by many throughout the county, and we are very appreciative for everybody who contributes to this collection. Though it is a collective effort, somebody still has to oversee this event, and this is where Melissa Joyce, Fire Marshal, and Jeremy Shelton, our Assistant Fire Marshal, come into play. And if y'all will start on up here while I talk about you. Melissa and Jeremy, they spearhead this toy collection sites that are located throughout the county. These sites are at fire departments, they're at government buildings, they're at private businesses. They put collection donation boxes all around the county. They even raised the bar this year because they had a decorated collection box contest, and the agency that had the best decorated collection box won an award, if I'm not mistaken, Williamsburg won that award for the best decorated collection box. In late November, Jeremy and Melissa go around to the county and they collect all the toy boxes. They bring them back to the office. They sort the toys. They box the toys up. They do it by category of trains and dolls and different types of toys. And if you've ever been in our training room, it's pretty large, and this encompasses every table that we have, multiple boxes. And when it's all said and done, these boxes usually fill up two large enclosed trailers. So it's a very large event. It's not something that is done over a day or a short period of time. Melissa and Jeremy then coordinate the delivery dates with the burn centers, and they even further coordinate a convoy of emergency vehicles who assist with the delivery of these toys. The fire departments put their trucks in the convoy, and they make it a big event for the children and all those people that are receiving these toys. I've actually been a part of that, and I've seen the delight on even the workers' faces at the hospitals when they start receiving these toys, because it's a huge event. The positive impacts of this event are immeasurable, but a few that need to be mentioned are, number one, this event brings together an entire county of citizens, communities, business owners, emergency responders, and municipalities for the common goal of selfless giving during the holiday season. Secondly, these selfless acts not only provide a meaningful Christmas to those patients who are in the burn center, but it relieves families of an obligation to go out and buy the cherished Christmas gifts because they're donated. They can go collect them and give them to their loved ones. So tonight, we're going to recognize Melissa and Jeremy, but the award is for the overall Burn Children's Fund that is through the Rockingham County Fire Officers Commission. But Melissa and Jeremy spearhead this event. Deanna actually was at the Fire Life Safety Conference, and she received the award because it was actually presented a few weeks ago at the conference. So, Melissa and Jeremy.
Welcome.
It says, the North Carolina J.C. Burn Center Special Recognition Award. In grateful appreciation for your support in 2023, this award is being presented to Rockingham County Chapter Firefighters Burn Children Fund, presented February 2024. Congratulations.
All I can say is thank you to everybody who supports this program. This by far is not mine, it's not Jeremy's. This is the Rockingham County Chapter of the Burn Children's Fund. Fire departments work very hard collecting everything. They come, they help us sort things, they help us sort toys, they help us box everything up, they help us get them labeled. And I'll be honest with you, they have to put up with a lot because I'm pretty difficult to work with when it comes to packing boxes. But I'm like, y'all sort everything and leave me alone, I'll pack them. So and that's the honest goodness truth. But they are so important. A lot of people don't realize the number of burn patients that go through these hospitals. They go to, y'all heard Kate say that they go to Baptist as well as Chapel Hill. Chapel Hill and Baptist each see over 1,200 adults every year. And they see over 600 children every year through their burn center. So this helps them not just for the Christmas holiday. They actually use this throughout the entire year. So if there's a parent who's in there, they need to recover from being burned or being hurt. Then their child's got a birthday or a holiday coming up. They can take them down the hall to the toy room and let them pick out things for their toy for their kids. Whether it's, you know, like I said, Christmas, birthday, Easter, it doesn't matter. They do it. The kids are there. They do holiday celebrations with them. So their focus is on getting healed up so that they can get back home. So this is not for us. I promise you, this goes out to every single person who participates in it, including all the people that donate to the cause. So we really appreciate the continued support that our county has shown.
Congratulations.
What do we do with our certificates? Okay.
Let me give this to you. Here's a certificate of appreciation to Assistant Fire Marshal Jeremy Shelton. Thank you. This is from all the county commissioners and Fire Marshal Melissa Joyce.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Those are always great. Next item on our agenda is approval of the March 18th, 2024 agenda. Gentlemen, do we have a motion?
You have a motion to approve the agenda as printed.
Do we have a second?
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed. Very good. We have an approved agenda. The next item is our consent agenda. Now, items on the consent agenda are non-controversial items. However, if anyone has questions about any of these items, please contact our county manager, Lance Metzler. Gentlemen, at this time, would someone care to make a motion for the consent agenda approval?
Make a motion to accept.
Thank you. We have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Very good. Thank you. We have an approved consent agenda. Next item is public hearing or public comment. And we do have one person signed up to speak tonight. I'll ask our manager, if you would, to give us the guidelines, please.
The public comment period should be for the purpose of allowing members of the public to present any matter pertaining to county business or items on the Board of Commissioners' agenda. Remarks should be addressed directly to the Board of Commissioners and not to the staff, the audience, or media. The chairperson will open the public comment period. Any speaker who wishes to speak shall approach the podium and not speak from his or her seat. Each speaker should clearly state his or her name and fiscal address when he or she approaches the podium. Each person shall be allotted 3 minutes. Your time will be displayed on the monitor in front of you. The time clock will start with 3 minutes. You will hear a beep at 1 minute to alert you to wrap up your comments. Speakers appearing before the Board of Commissioners will not be allowed to campaign for public office, promote private business ventures, or use language of a personal nature which insults or demeans any person or which, when directed at a public official, is not related to his or her official duties. The Board of Commissioners may accept written comments in lieu of oral statements. Written statements can be delivered to the County Manager's office. Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Manager. With that, we'll ask Michael Pergerson to make your way up to the podium. And give us your name and address, Mr. Pergerson.
Michael Pergerson, 10614, North Carolina Highway 700. It's about the new fire district for Ruffin. I live already in the fire district, and from my understanding, they're going to take me from my district and into theirs. The tax rate, the difference on it, would go from $130 for them. From now, it's $61.40. It would go to $130 a year just on my property. And the only difference is that I've seen, that I've talked, every rating, fire department has a rating. The department I'm in has a 6. Ruffin has a 5. And when I checked with my insurance company, it's very little bit of difference in savings on the fire insurance. So, that's all I got.
Ferguson, we appreciate you speaking tonight. And that's the only person we had signed up to speak in public comment. So with that, we'll move on to public hearings. And item 8A, Lee Cockrum, Director of Rockingham County Center for Economic Development. Good evening, Lee.
Good evening. Thank you for having me. As you are aware, on February the 28th, we announced dry lock technologies as a new industry coming to Reidsville, to the 1900 Barn Street address, the old Ball Building, and then Albod, most recently was there. This project, or this public hearing now, is to consider approval of an appropriation from our general fund in the amount not to exceed $618,000. For local tax incentives that will be distributed to Project DL or Project Drylock following the project parameters as approved through our local performance agreement. This project was also awarded a 1NC of $300,000, and the local match for that will be met through $618,000 local incentive.
Very good. Do we have any questions, gentlemen?
Yes. How much is the local match?
Up to, so not to exceed, $618,000.
That is the local match for the...
Oh, sorry, the local match is, $25,000.
$25,000?
Yes.
Thank you.
And this is a $30 million project with 150 jobs.
Very good. Any other questions?
I got a couple. Not directly related to this, but if you would, while you're here, can you give the process a little bit for the public, because there's been some... not misconceptions, but thinking they don't actually know how we get leads or we get economic development, how it comes through the state into here. Can you explain that just a little bit for the public?
Sure. So our office handles all industrial recruitment for Rockingham County. So whether those are leads that come from the state's organization, which is the Economic Development Partnership of North Carolina, they have one contact in each county of which they go to when they have industrial leads that perhaps could, you know, we have a building or a site that meets a requirement. But we also do our own outreach and generation. So this project, for example, actually came to us directly and not through EDPNC. We then brought in, and that's sorry, the acronym for Economic Development Partnership of North Carolina, we brought them into the project as the project continued to move along. They were looking at a couple of other sites in throughout the Southeast and in Wisconsin. So it's a variety of ways that we get economic development leads, whether it's through the state or through generated, you know, on our own. We market our sites and our buildings also by ourselves, and we have relationships with company executives and site selection consultants, you know, all over the globe, but in the United States in particular.
Most of the time when we get a company that's coming here and the state's involved, it comes to us under a code name. Is that correct?
Yes, which is why I referenced earlier Project DL. That was the code name for this one, yes.
And so your office may know who the actual person is or the company is, but most likely the commissioners will not know anything but the code name. Is that correct? Under the economic development rules. Is that
right.
Correct?
Correct, yes.
Thank you for addressing that.
Yes.
Any other comments?
So you referenced site readiness earlier. So was there anything financially that we had put into the site prior to the DL project?
No, not at all. This is an existing building that we hadn't done anything with. Yeah.
Thank you.
Very good. Any further? Gentlemen, at this time, we're going to open the public hearing.
Oh, yeah.
Well, and with that said, we've had no one signed up to speak.
Thank y'all.
So with that, we will close the public hearing, and we'll save our attorney from having to read the guidelines on that. Well, gentlemen, is any further discussion on this? We've held our public hearing. We've asked a few questions. Any further discussion? Is there a motion for approval?
Chair, I move approval of this request as printed.
We have a motion. Is there a second? We have a motion and a second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Thank you. Motion carries.
Great. Thank you.
Next item is item B, Hiram Marziano, Community Development Director.
I'm not taking you off my Christmas card.
Good evening.
Good evening, y'all. Let me get this. There we go. All right, I have three cases for y'all tonight. The first case is rezoning 2024-03. This is a request for a zoning map amendment of a parcel of land from residential agricultural to highway commercial. It's located off of U.S. Highway 29, right there at the Mayfield Loop. This is in the Ruffin Township. It's a straight conventional rezoning, and the Planning Board at the February 12th meeting did recommend approval unanimously. As you can see on the vicinity map, we're in our, for a change of pace, in our northeast part of the county. Here's the current zoning. You'll see that it's next to OI right there is a power substation. There's a highway commercial, and then this little triangle that's hashed right there at the intersection with the highway is the parcel in question. It's in our O2 land use on our future land use map, which is a highway commercial would not technically be consistent, but we do feel that it is reasonable in the, given the nature of the immediate highway commercial adjacent, also being off the highway and an exit ramp onto said highway. Just a parcel view. And again, this is in our O2 land class. The plan does try to promote new development for commercial opportunities under economic development goals. And we do find this not to be consistent, but we do find it to be reasonable. And so did the Planning Board.
So the planning board voted for this?
Voted for this to recommend approval to y'all, yes.
Very good. Thank you. Gentlemen, do we have any questions?
A quick one there, Marzi. How big is this parcel?
It's roughly 0.8 acres, so not quite a full acre, but it well exceeds the 20,000 square feet minimum for highway commercial.
The project to go there, is it going to be within this rezoned area, or is it going to take in some of those adjoining properties?
It's going to be, from my understanding, whatever the person wants to use this for meets our standards, or meets our use table, but it's just that parcel. It's not being combined to the other parcels.
Thank you.
So setbacks and such would apply?
Yes.
Very good. Any other questions, gentlemen? With that, we will open public hearing for case 2024-04. And again, well, I'm sorry, 03. And again, we've had no one sign up to speak on this case for or against. So we will close the public hearing. Gentlemen, any further questions? If not, we'll accept a motion.
Mr. Chair, I make a motion to approve ordinance for case number 2004-03.
Thank you. Do we have a motion? Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thank you. All righty, this takes us to 8B2.
This is rezoning case 2024-04. This is a request for the zoning map amendment for a parcel of land from residential agricultural to light industrial. The location is our water tower at 147 Sylvania Road. This is in Huntsville's Township. This is a straight rezoning. The planning board at the same meeting of February 12th recommended unanimously to recommend approval of this rezoning. Vicinity map, this is over by the industrial park. It's that last little bit of corner right there. That's where our water tower sits. The property just south of that is located for a future fire department. The rezoning has been requested specifically so that the fire department layout and the size and structure can meet the property standards without having to force it to setback issues with the driveway. It's not on this map yet, but Boone Road's to be realigned closer to the center of that property across the street from it, which necessitates them having to shift the building on the property. So they need setback changes, which the only way they can get that would be to rezone this property to have it so that the setbacks would be reduced. This is in our G3 land use corridor. LI is highly acceptable in that jurisdiction. And just for reference, again, this is where the water tower in the area is located.
Back up, I did have a question.
Mm-hmm.
So we're rezoning the property the water tower is on.
Right.
The fire department will be built directly to the south of that.
Correct. That property just south of Cross Street from Boone Road.
Okay. All right.
And like I said, the realignment of Boone Road is causing a lot of this issue. Their driveway can't go right straight across from the entrance.
Okay.
And we find it to be reasonable. There's nothing about that property that says the current use of it's allowed in LI as well. There'd be no nonconformities, nothing like that.
And our planning board?
Planning board voted unanimously to recommend approval, citing consistency and reasonableness.
Okay, thank you. Gentlemen, do we have any questions, any discussion? With that, we will open the public hearing for case 2024-04. And yet again, we've had no one sign up to speak for or against that case. So with that, we'll close the public hearing at this time. And gentlemen, we'll be looking for a motion if there's no further discussion.
So moved.
We have a motion. Is there a second?
Second.
We have a motion and a second for approval of case 2024-04. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Oppose. Thank you. This brings us to our third item, case number 2024-05.
I
Another zoning map amendment. This would be for a parcel of land from residential protected to residential agricultural. Another straight rezoning. This is located at 1060 Vernon Road. It's just east of the Wentworth town limits. It's in the Simpsonville Township, and the planning board voted unanimously to recommend approval of the rezoning. Here you can see it's just right outside the city limits of Wentworth. It's that hashed mark. There's two pieces of property there that are zoned residential protected. The other one actually has a manufactured home on it right now, which would be non-conforming. This property is just the front of that parcel. Those aren't the same parcel. If you notice that a horseshoe's around, that goes back to the other parcel. So just this is about 1 acre of land right up there against Vernon Road. Just zoom out, the entirety of most of that area, with the exception of the corner over there in Wentworth limits, are mostly RA. It is in the Dan River Eden watershed, but there's no environmental features adjacent to the parcel that may be affected that we could determine from existing mapping. It's in our O2 land use for the future land use map, which does correlate to rezoning properties to residential agricultural. And again, just a quick overshot of the property. Any questions?
Very good, thank you.
Oh, Junior? I should mention, I apologize, y'all might have gotten a packet. We did have someone submit about 9 letters, I believe in opposition to this, from the surrounding neighbors.
Thank you, Marzi. Yes, we did receive that packet. We have reviewed those.
To make sure y'all got them.
Thank you. With that, gentlemen, do we have any questions regarding this piece of property?
I do.
Yes, Commissioner Powell.
Did you say the property that's marked RP beside of it is non-conforming because it has a mobile home or double wide or something on it?
Yeah, there at 1072 is a manufactured home, but also at 1074 just behind it is one as well. These are legacies, we believe. From prior to zoning the property to RP. But yeah, that area itself has, I bring that up because I don't know why they were zoned RP to begin with, is the point I'm getting at, because if the existing house wouldn't have been allowed prior to that, these two parcels right there are the only ones in the area zoned RP. I can't find a reason for why they were done that way when it was zoned.
1040 RA, but that's a stick-built house, is that correct?
It's either stick-built or modular. I believe it's a modular.
Modular, okay. All right. Thank you.
And in case anyone wants to know the difference between a modular and a manufactured home, they're both built in factories. One's built to federal HUD standards. One's built to North Carolina Building Code standards. The modular being North Carolina Building Code.
But the zoning of 1040, can you go back to the zoning?
Yes, sir. It is RA. Here we go. Let me zoom in. Yeah.
That's it.
Very good. Any further questions?
I have a question. Just regarding the history of this parcel, when was it originally zoned RP? When we began zoning, or was there ever a change?
1988, when we started zoning.
So from the beginning, this was zoned RP?
From the beginning, these two parcels were zoned RP.
And I know I'm asking you to read somebody's mind, but do you have any idea why these were zoned RP, if they're just on the side of the road and it's not intersection or anything like that?
The best I could figure, if I had to guess, is they came through, and if you notice over there at the Wentworth city limits, that is RP through on that intersection.
Right.
They mirrored it, but maybe the people between didn't want to. They may have canvassed the area and requested it, and they may have wanted to stay into more rural. I'm not sure. It's not uncommon for us to see these just splotched throughout the whole county, and in certain places. Sometimes they're intersections, sometimes they're on stretches. But I don't have any records from the time to get a reason or rhyme.
I understand, but not necessarily because somebody had ever requested it to be. It just sort of picked it.
Right, not according to our records.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Berger?
And Marzi, just for really the public to understand, so RA is our lowest classification or least dense classification on the
correct
zoning scale.
Right.
Okay, so RP, of course, would be a more dense or a higher classification.
Right. We have it as a higher classification, more dense, but also more regulated.
Okay, nothing further.
Commissioner Richardson?
I understand the criteria for allowable is going to change in the near future, and that would be an impact on RP. Is that correct?
Yes, we do have a text amendment going to the planning board next month that would affect properties like this and similar with the availability to have Class AA, which are double-wides, manufactured homes allowable with more restrictive measures in the RP district that would be different than the measures in the RA district.
Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner Powell?
Marzi, I'm not sure this is a proper question, but I know that it was talked about, I believe, in the planning board, the value of this piece of property once the owners do what they're going to do with it. Can we share that?
I believe someone from Clayton's here. If you want to ask them exactly the value, I knew the number. Know the number tossed out at the planning board meeting was over $200,000.
Could we have him come forward?
I believe there's be time for. If you want to talk now, that's great.
Yeah. Well, I mean, we can do it later. It doesn't matter to me.
If you want to do it during the public hearing or now, I don't.
That's fine.
Okay.
Now. Yes, sir.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir.
I'm Jeff Griggs, Clayton Homes, Reidsville, North Carolina. The value is going to be somewhere around $234,000 to $250,000 when it's finished.
That includes the site work on the property?
That's correct. Construction, home, and land.
And I think that the planning board was told that this would be a double wide. Is that correct?
That is correct. It's going to be a double wide, not a mod.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you, Margie. Do we have any other questions? That being the case, we are going to open the public hearing for case 2024-05. And yet again, we've had no one sign up to speak for or against this case. So with that, we will close the public hearing. And gentlemen, any further discussion? If not, we'll be looking for a motion.
Make a motion to approve.
Yes, thank you, Commissioner Powell. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a second. Thank you, Commissioner Berger. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Thank you. Thank you, Margie.
Thank you all very much.
Item 9 on our agenda is a presentation by the Fire Marshal Melissa Joyce and Fire Chief Jonathan Compton. Welcome back.
Thank you. This is the first time I've been up here, so y'all bear with me. So do you all, they sent you all the maps and everything.
Just say that again.
Did you all receive a map and the report?
Yeah, I think it's in our packet, yes.
Okay. So I just want to go through, the Ruffin Fire Department has requested to incorporate some non-rated area. They currently have a Ruffin district, and that's actually spelled out on your map. You'll be able to see it on there. And so Ruffin has, they came into some money, and I can let Chief Compton explain that. They received a grant in order to be able to build a substation. Where the substation is located on NC 700, this substation is going to allow them to take a very large area that is non-rated, which means it's in a protection class 10. Those people, they still have fire service that comes out there to them, but they're outside of the 5-mile district. Some of them are outside of the 6-mile district, which puts them in the protection class 10, which means their homeowners insurance premiums are extremely high. So when Ruffin was able to choose the right location to build the substation, this is going to allow them to incorporate everybody in their entire district, being within a 5-mile district of the fire station, allowing everyone to be under the protection class of 5, which is an insurance rating. At the same time, the Pelham Fire Chief approached them and told them that they would be willing to relinquish their district that's in our county so that when Ruffin created their service district, it would overlay the entire district. So with that, to be proactive, last year in February of 2023, Ruffin Fire Department held a community meeting. This community meeting was advertised in the newspaper, on social media, in the churches in the area that was the existing Ruffin District, as well as the proposed Ruffin District, and included the Pelham District and all of the area businesses. Ruffin Fire Department was very specific in their advertising regarding the meeting because they wanted the people to be aware that it was going to be about the construction of their new station, the new service district, the tax rates, because it was going to affect, and I have a color one here, if that may make it better.
need Allison's help.
And if we need to fold that under that way, I'll hold it in place, we can do that.
Oh, we have to turn it on. That'll work.
No, it's not on that map.
Damn, just a little bit. There we go.
So right now, you can see this pink area is the existing Ruffin District. This green area up here that's highlighted around with the red, that's the non-rated area where the insurance premiums are extremely high. And this area here is the Pelham District. And Chief Comp can show you exactly where they're Ruffin, well, not exactly pinpoint, but he can show you the area that it is. So where he drew this dot right here, that's where their new proposed station is going to be. Well, it's not proposed, the actual station is constructed.
Yeah, that's not the right spot. It's actually right here. That's where we'll
go. Want him to draw it to scale.
Is that to scale?
These maps are really small. I apologize. This is, like I said, it's my first time coming up here. Okay. I can tell you that this new service district will overlay the entire district. It will include the non-rated area as well as the Pelham District. And the benefits that it's going to bring to that area is going to be quicker response times for any emergencies. It's going to help with those currently non-rated areas that are now going to be rated areas. And when they had their meeting in February of last year, they actually had their insurance company in that area, one of the ones that's very prominent, actually run them quotes on how much those people in the non-rated area would potentially save in homeowners insurance. And that was going to be anywhere from $200 to $800. And then another thing is that, you know, it's picking up the Pelham District that's currently in our county of where Pelham's coming out of Caswell County into Rockingham County. And I do understand, and like I said, I understand that it is a slight increase in what their taxes are going to be for that area. They're going to truly benefit from it. And also, the non-rated areas is also is the big focus on it, is being able to get a response time and get those times in and get them down so that the people in that area can be better protected with better service and quicker responses. And is there anything you want to add, Chief?
That sounds pretty good. You know, we started working on this project just a couple of years ago, trying to get those folks into that, into a rated area. You know, we already serviced that area, but we were not in a position at that time to really service that area effectively. But by building a new station there, that gives us a lot more flexibility, and it allows us to service that area very effectively. And you can see how close we're going to be located to the current Pelham District. But that, like I said, that again is in Rockingham County, so that would allow us to service that area more effectively than Pelham can.
Okay. Very good. Thank you. Gentlemen, do we have any questions? Commissioner Richardson?
Yeah, this is, you heard Mr. Ferguson. I'm a little bit curious why his bills are going up.
So currently,
his tax bill is going up.
Well, currently, he's in Pelham's district, and they tax at 6 cents on a $100 valuation. Ruffin's going to tax at 13 cents on a $100 valuation. So he will see a slight increase in taxes in his 4-5 district tax.
As well as every resident that's in the
every Ruffin, resident in
I mean,
that non-rated
in the yes. Pelham district will.
Yeah. Now you may not know this, but if you do, how does 6 cents tax fire tax compare to the rest of Rockingham County?
As far as what the tax rates are across the county,
right?
6 cent per hundred is extremely low. I would say I'm averaging. I would say if I had to do an average, just right off the top of my head, not having the numbers in front of me, they're probably averaging 9 to 10 cent per hundred as an average overall. We've got some departments that are at 13.5 cent, some that are 11.5 cent, some that are 10 cent. You know, that Pelham district is at 6 cent. We've got another district that I think is at 6.5. But majority, if we do an overall average, it's going to be right around the 9.5 to 10 cent.
And anybody in the Pelham District will be moving from a Cat 6 to a Cat 5. What is that going to cut? How much help, insurance premium-wise, is that going to be?
It's It's not going to be as much as what the people that are in the non-rated area are. As far as a dollar amount, I don't have that information for you. I can research that for you and get that back to you. But the
No. I'm talking, I was interested in this before. The bottom line is the folks that are in the non-rated area are going to benefit financially. And those folks that were fortunate enough to be under 6 cents per hundred in the Pelham district are likely to suffer some monetary reduction or increase. It's not going to be as good for them.
I will say that our future plans, you know, is to have a part-time person in that station, you know, Monday through Friday, 8 to 5, similar to what we do in our current station. So that will provide a much quicker response to those folks in that Pelham district. So at some point in the future, hopefully they will see, you know, a benefit of being in that fire district and somebody being in that fire station.
Oh, I'm sure they will. Just looking at it and knowing where the Pelham station is in comparison over in Caswell County. But do you think that will get them a lower rate than five insurance rate?
I'm not going to speculate on if we can get a lower rate at some point in the future. It is possible. It's a lot of work involved in trying to get your insurance rate lowered. You know, we were able to go from a 9 to a 5 a few years ago, and which made a significant difference in our district at that point. Can we go lower? It's possible, but it's a lot of work involved to make it happen. But we've been working toward that. And we'll just kind of see how things play out over the next couple of years.
Thank you. I thought the public would be interested in these comparisons. And, of course, we're interested in public safety. And is it fair to say if you live in the Pelham District, you're going to be more better, pardon my English?
I think so. I mean, we currently assist Pelham on mutual aid several times a week, you know, due to a lack of their staffing in the daytime. And I know they're all volunteer and they have no part-time people in Pelham. So we do try to keep a part-time person in the daytime in Ruffin.
That's all I have.
Very good. Any questions?
Yes.
Gentlemen, Commissioner Berger.
So the majority of that Pelham district is in Caswell County.
No, that's all Rockingham County.
Yeah, but I'm talking about the overall fire district. The majority of that district is actually in Caswell County. The majority of
yes.
it. Okay. And what you've got as far as helping with the response times is a new fire department that was part of the state budget through Senator Berger and Representative Pirtle that did not cost the taxpayers locally any local funds. Is that right?
That's correct.
Okay. All right. Nothing further.
Very good. Thank you. Gentlemen, Commissioner Barrow.
Mr. Chair, for the benefit of this whole conversation and public information, in this non-rated area here, what is the current tax rate for those people for the fire district?
They currently don't pay any taxes.
Thank you.
How about the Ruffin rate? What is that, the current Ruffin rate?
Yeah, the current Ruffin rate is 13 cents.
Okay. Yes, go ahead.
So that current rate was based on the old Ruffin district, right?
Yes.
Without this new area that we're talking about. Is there a possibility that you guys would be able to reduce that rate taking on that? Is there enough tax base out there to do that or not?
You know, with inflation and the way things cost now, I don't foresee that being a possibility.
Okay.
And staffing. An additional staff member.
Yeah, and like I said, you know, this additional tax revenue is hopefully going to open us up to an additional staff person that I can put at that new station. So that would be an additional cost that we would have. So sure. I don't think we'd be at a lower tax rate.
So one more question from Melissa. It's, you know, I know on the eastern side, it's not, we have Pelham who comes into Rockingham County, their district extends, and also Casville. That extends into Rockingham County. Do you know by any chance what the rate for Casville is as opposed to Yanceyville Road?
I do not right offhand. I can get that information for you.
I was just wondering, is there, since Pelham has so graciously relinquished their part of that district. Is there a chance that Caswell would do the same thing and we'd have most of our fire departments operating in Rockingham County?
It's definitely something I can look into.
Any more discussion, gentlemen? With that, we will look for a motion on this topic.
If I may, the statute requires the commission consider five things, and it's in the memo I did. It's very specific the way you set up these districts, and the first thing is you've got to realize that there's 1,229 residents and 1,680 tax parcels. The second thing, the appraised value of the property must be considered. It's currently $142,383,992. The third thing you consider is the present tax rate, which you've already discussed. It's 13 cents per 100 in Ruffin, and Pelham is 6 cents per 100. The fourth thing by statute you have to discuss is the, or consider, is the availability of proposed district to sustain these additional taxes. And the fifth thing is any other matter the commissioners want to consider bearing on whether the service district should be established. After you have considered all that, then you need to find four things according to the statute. You have to find there's a demonstrable need for providing the service. It's impossible or impractical to provide it on a countywide basis through another fire department. It's economically feasible to provide the proposed services in the district without unreasonable or burdensome annual tax levies. And there is a demonstrable demand for the proposed services by persons residing in the district. And the fire marshal and I put together a report, which is the next requirement for fire protection service in the district, which you should have in the memo. And in that report, it sets forth a statement showing the proposed district meets the standards set out and a plan for providing them. So that's all in the report. And the next thing I'll ask you to do is to set a public hearing for May 6th. And then we have some advertising to do. The residents have to be notified of the date of the public hearing, and the clerk has to publish the date of the public hearing at least 4 weeks before the date of the public hearing. So she's got to go ahead and publish that if you set it for May 6th. And then you hold your public hearing and the folks in the fire district can come, and we publish that notice at least once, but not less than 1 week before the date of the hearing. But we have to mail a little postcard to every single resident telling them that this is the plan and that they can look at this map in the fire marshal's office, or they can come up and look at the map in the clerk's office. And having said all that, that concludes all the requirements set forth under 153A302.
So with that, with this approval of this proposal tonight, included in this approval would be to set this public hearing for May 6th and those other items that you have brought to our attention tonight.
Yes. If you do all of those things, you've met the requirement of the statute. The biggest thing is the notice to every single resident. And I believe our planning department is going to assist with that. And our tax department has given us all the addresses we need.
Very good. Very good. Gentlemen, with that, do we have a motion for approval of this proposed Ruffin Fire Protection Service District?
Well, I have a question, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
Based on what Mr. Albright said, are we finding the four factors that he talked about?
If we approve this presentation, yes, that's what we're doing.
And so, Mr. Albright, what four factors did you think that we've proven here with this? And I'm particularly concerned about the Pelham Fire Department area. That's the area that
says you must find that all of these following things apply. Number one, there's a demonstrable need for providing the fire district protection services. The second thing is that it is impossible or impractical to provide the services through another fire department. Third thing is it's economically feasible to provide the proposed services in the district without unreasonable or burdensome tax levies. And the fourth thing is there is a demonstrable demand for the proposed services by the persons residing in the district. And I'm just assuming that's the non-rated residents that would be demanding this.
Right.
Is that correct?
That would be correct.
Okay.
Therefore, I'm a little bit confused, I guess. So we're going to have to take the district as they presented it tonight, because there it probably is, in the eyes of the public, an unreasonable tax increase from the Pelham to the proposed Ruffin area. They already have fire protection there, so I don't believe there would be a demonstrable need there. So what else do we have? That's two out of five that I can say for the for the Pelham area, which only leaves three left. Am I thinking correctly?
Well, we've heard testimony from the fire marshal and the chief here that there's a need for providing it for the non-rated areas. And Pelham would be getting the same service if you expand the district. Is that correct?
That's correct.
The second question is it impractical to provide those through another fire department?
Mr. Chair, I would say whatever motion we do, we're considering a proposal, and these four items, certainly including the ones that are questionable, would have to be considered in or prior to the public hearing, but not necessarily tonight.
This is just for purposes of calling a public hearing on May 6th, and then you can take whatever the public brings to you and have more questions for the fire marshal before you decide to enlarge this fire district.
So I'm good with that. I guess the last question that I have, and I'm probably not asking it correctly, is it possible to consider, not that I am, but to consider this district without the Pelham district, which already has fire service? That's the question I'm asking.
Well, yes. I mean, you could draw this district any way you want to draw it.
But
that's the purpose.
But the non-rated district has fire service courtesy of Ruffin, does it not?
That's correct.
Mr. Chair, my understanding is that we are considering the district that you've proposed. We're not creating a district. This is the district that you have proposed. Is that correct?
That's correct.
So that's what we will be considering, is
right.
What they proposed?
So if we approve this tonight, we will be approving the advertisement and a May 6th public hearing to take place. At that time, we'll hear more evidence, we'll hear more testimony, and then just one public hearing, or will it be two public hearings?
Statute requires one.
So we would make a decision at that time.
Yes.
So tonight, if we decide to move ahead, this is not the final decision. It'll just be deciding to have that public hearing on May 6th.
Mr. Chair, I make a motion to set the public hearing for the proposed fire district.
Is that an appropriate motion, Mr. Attorney?
May 6th.
On May 6th.
Yes.
All right, we have a second, a motion and a second. Any further questions or discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Very good. Thank you, folks. We look forward to seeing you in May.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Very good. Our next item is a presentation by Captain Jennifer Brown.
Good evening. Tonight I want to make a presentation. We are asking to use equitably shared funds, or our federal forfeiture funds, to pay for billboard rental for 1 year for advertisement and recruitment purposes. It would also be used for other safety, public safety purposes, such as public service messages for anti-fentanyl, anti-drug, anti-littering messages, public service announcements for Crime Stoppers, or encouraging the citizens to
report crimes, you know, anonymously. Any type of crime issues that we have, wanted persons, domestic violence awareness. But this would be a billboard rental. We've previously done this for the past year. We're asking to renew again using the equity shared funds, which are non-taxpayer funds. This request does fall between the Department of Justice's equity shared funds guidelines for state, local, and tribal law enforcement agencies, most specifically Section 5B1A, which is permissible uses. It falls under the section for law enforcement administrative costs that further the agency's law enforcement goals or missions, an example of which would be recruitment and advertisement costs. So that's why we are asking tonight to be able to use those funds for another year or 13 periods for use of this electronic billboard that is located currently on Freeway Drive in Reidsville. Have any questions?
What is the expense, anticipated expense for these?
For the 13 periods, which would cover the year, it would be $10,725 for the 13 periods or 13 actual months.
Okay. Thank you. Gentlemen, do we have any questions?
I do.
Yes, Commissioner Richardson.
We've had some discussion about this, and I certainly don't have a problem, especially since you added this public information aspect. Within the county, we haven't had much success with billboard advertisement as far as getting new personnel. But I don't know how to phrase this exactly. It would be nice, and I don't know how you do it, Sheriff or Jennifer, but see if we could measure the impact in a future time. And you guys would be more expert in determining some sort of criteria that you could lay out. I think it would be a tough metric, but we really ought to know what we're getting for our money.
For specifically for the recruitment purposes, we could speak to Apple.
It could be recruitment. I'm talking about the whole package.
Okay.
Frankly, I'm more interested in your anti-opioid and fentanyl and so forth program.
Colonel, if I may say this also, I agree with you, we definitely need to measure, because we don't generally ask, you know, did you see it on the billboard or something like that. So I appreciate that. The good thing about this electronic system is we can change it at any time. We got a missing person comes up or whatever comes up, if we can put it out there, we can get it out there pretty quick through the billboard company. So, but again, measuring the effectiveness on it, I agree with you 100%. Yes, sir.
Well, if it was easy, I could do it, but I appreciate its responsiveness. Remind the public exactly where this billboard is.
It's on Freeway Drive in Reidsville, located near the Elizabeth's Pizza. That section there, Mayflower, that area right there, is where the billboard is. If you're heading north, it is on that side of the road.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Comments, any questions? Commissioner Berger?
Mainly for Lance. I mean, as far as vacancies in the county, I think the last number I heard overall was around 31. Is that right?
34, yes, sir.
34?
Yep.
I believe close to half of those are in the Sheriff's Department.
It's 14, yes, sir.
Okay. What are other departments in the county doing? Are they using billboards?
No, we tried that with EMS, with the paramedics, and it didn't work for us. So we trying all of the angles like LinkedIn and the other avenues of trying to get them on their website.
Okay. Has there been much communication with HR as far as what other departments are doing?
No, but I can certainly do that. I know we've tried our social media platforms, our county website, you know, your Facebooks and everything else. We're trying every avenue that we can. We've actually held symposiums there for detention officers. We've held a couple of those, and we've advertised for those to allow people to come in and ask questions and find out what it means to be a detention officer. So we're trying everything that we can to recruit and get folks in that want to come to work.
Okay.
The hardest, I think we've got 7 or 8
yes.
there that are missing. They're the most difficult to recruit.
And if I can may add something else, is they're looking to go in toward from 600 some hours in rookie school to 800 some hours. So it's going to be more months. More months. They haven't increased on the detention officers yet, but still, detention officers is really the toughest. But it's also getting tough with road officers also.
And are we having much luck with, I know some of the cities are starting to pay for BLET, and I think the county has been doing that for some period of time. I don't know how long. Are we having much luck with that?
I think we're in our second,
yes,
second cycle of paying, but also we also do require a contract. So if someone bails right afterwards, we can recoup some of our loss, thanks to our county manager and our county attorney helping us on that.
And I know the latest BLET class has only got, I think, seven.
And four of those are for us. We have actually four from the sheriff's office, or four.
We had to get special permission in order to have that class.
That's correct.
Due
yes,
to
sir.
The low numbers. So.
Yes,
okay.
And that's what we've kind of, since COVID, we've kind of seen that trend is just low numbers. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay.
Yes, Commissioner Powell.
So, Sheriff, I actually have a question about a prior request that you made coming out of this same fund. Back in September the 5th, I believe it was, you came before this board and asked for two cars, one to replace one that had been wrecked, and then one as a used vehicle for some, I don't remember what the purpose was.
Undercover vehicle.
Undercover
yes,
vehicle. And then some pistols.
Yes,
is
sir.
Is that correct? And on March 2nd, and I have the video if I need to refresh your mind.
First of all, I'm going to say one thing. Is I'm staying on the topic for tonight. I'm not going to vary from it. If you want to put it on agenda later, we can do that. But I'm following the guidelines tonight, and I'm answering questions on our request specifically for the use of asset forfeiture money tonight.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to ask you about the request then, so you can choose to answer or
yeah,
not.
Go ahead, sir.
Have you received the pistols that we approved on September the 5th?
I did.
And the night of March the 2nd, when you told the public that you felt like we had defunded you, were you indeed wearing that pistol while you were in that church making that statement?
I'll explain myself completely, is that I requested two vehicles. We never had to ask before during a budget session for an extra vehicle purchased through asset forfeiture. We've been ready to purchase out of cycle because we've been trying to avoid and stay in compliance with the federal law as it applies to supplanting our budget. That night, you approved one of the vehicles that was paid for by insurance, and then you approved the weapon systems after a general long inquiry about weapon systems. And I should know more about than most of you gentlemen out here on the needs of weapon systems in our organization. But when we asked for a replacement of the narcotics vehicle, which was an out-of-cycle request, it was brought to our attention that it should have been requested during the budget process. I was trying to avoid being caught under the supplanting issue. So I was following what we thought was right. You had a different opinion.
But we did supply the pistols.
But in my opinion, when we're not allowed to use asset forfeiture money for law enforcement purpose, that is defunding the police.
But we did supply you with the pistols.
You did supply the pistols.
Specifically in your remarks.
But you denied me the vehicle, and therefore I had a vehicle with 150,000 miles on it that still got over 150,000 miles on it, not replaced. Now, we have complied with your request, but I consider that defunding process. Because those monies can only be used for law enforcement purpose according to the federal law, period.
Does that mean that, but does that purpose mean that we have to approve each of those requests? I mean, does that money come to the county or does it come to you?
It comes to the county in our budget line item under seized asset forfeiture, and that you are a pass-through. If you don't approve, we don't spend it. If we don't get to spend it, then I contact DOJ and tell them I'm not allowed, being denied access, and allowed to spend these monies for law enforcement purpose. I'll contact DOJ, and they can take the money and give it to a law enforcement agency that wants to support and provide funding for their agency, extra money, as was asset forfeiture.
So on the night of September the 5th, though, we approved the guns. You've received the guns. You were carrying a gun. And in the same time, 3 years, the past 3 years, your budget's been increased by $3.5 or $3.7
million. I'd have to check that. Because there's other conversations that have come out of what you're reporting. And there's no funding that I have found from you that have supported enforcement, illegal immigration enforcement.
Mm-hmm.
I haven't seen that.
On
the $3 million, let me finish. On $3 million, I'd have to see specifically what that went to. Let me say this. In the past, you have been supportive, but also in the past, you have cut benefits in this organization and for county employees. We lost the benefit in 2017 that when we retire, we get a medical benefit paid for that employee. That benefit was snagged away from us in 2017. So you've got 600 some employees that when they retire, if they came in after 2017, they have no medical benefits provided.
Does all departments do that?
I don't know about all departments, but I know Reedsville right now.
Not unusual for other departments.
I'm going to ask you a question. I know that Reedsville, after 10 years of service, they provide that medical retirement for the employees. But you want to know why you can't get employees in law enforcement? It's because exactly what you're talking about. You're cutting benefits, and you expect to get people to come to work here with less benefits. And that's the problem. We're competing with every county, every city, and whoever's got the best benefits and the most pay, that's where they seem to go to.
And Sheriff, how many raises has your department gotten and you've gotten since 2021?
That's fine. We've got two raises.
No, you've gotten three.
Well, excuse me, three raises. But when you cut the benefits, what's next? Longevity?
Well, does that justify your comments to the public that we've defunded your department?
My comments are this, is when I have money available to support law enforcement and our mission to protect and serve the citizens, and I make a lawful request following the law, and you can't comply with that, to me, that's the defunding.
And how many vehicles did you get in the budget? This budget? I believe you're given a lump sum, and you choose how to buy the vehicles. Is that correct?
Stand by. Jennifer, how many vehicles?
We have to make a specific request for vehicles, and we ask for the vehicles by price, and then whether it's approved or not is up to the county.
So how many vehicles was it this year?
I think six, four patrol, one SUV, and one other. I can't remember what the other one was.
Detective vehicle. Yeah.
So,
wait a minute, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Give me 1 second. So we funded the ones in your budget, and then 45 days later you came back with this request that you said you didn't realize.
Following the same procedure that we followed in the past. So I didn't vary from what we had done before, and it wasn't brought to my attention, but since it has been brought to my attention, that is what you request, I'm following compliance with that, according to Derek Southern and the Finance Department. That's what we're following.
Right.
And we're going to follow your request. But again, I think in the future, you want to talk about it, you need to think about defunding or not funding and what benefits loss we have, because I'm concerned about not just 2 years, 3 years, but 5 years. But I'm concerned in the future of our county, are we going to be able to get employees to work the jobs here if we keep cutting the benefits? Salaries are great, and we appreciate it. We do appreciate it. But don't keep cutting our benefits, because we're competing with everybody else.
Just for the record, this board did not, or I was not on this board when you're talking about that, but I did make the motion to approve your pistols.
I think it stated that in 2017 you were not on the board.
That's correct.
And you have assisted, and you have been present during these salary increases. But salary increases are great. But every benefit we can pick up to help keep somebody to hire and retain is important to every county employee, not just the sheriff's office, every county employee. So I'll leave it at that. I'm not going to get in an argument over it. It's how I feel. It's what it is.
I'm done, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. I have one question. Lance, did we use county tax dollars to send Sheriff Page to Texas?
I think so, yes.
Thank you. No further questions.
To Texas, last year that was provided by Federation for American Immigration Reform.
I've got a copy of the receipt. It may have been a few years ago, but yeah.
A few years ago, yes, sir. But not recently, sir.
All right. Gentlemen, getting back to item 10.
I make a motion that we approve the billboards.
All right. Do we have a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? Very good. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Thank you, Ms. Brown. Thank you, Sheriff.
Thank you.
Mr. Manager, do we have any new business tonight?
No, sir.
Very good. That takes us to Commissioner comments, and we'll start with Commissioner Barrow.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just want to say thank you for everybody coming out tonight, and I wanted to recognize the Reedsville Rams High School coach Jason Ross and the basketball team for winning the men's 2A state North Carolina basketball championship over the weekend. I had the pleasure of going and attending that game in Winston, and it was very exciting. Easily the most exciting high school basketball game I've ever watched. Went into overtime. It was a heck of a game, and the Rams came out on top. So congratulations to all those guys. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Richardson.
Yeah, well, thank you to all of you for being here. Mr. Pergerson, I guess you're going to have to come back there to make your comments. But we do appreciate the public input and the public opinion as provided. I also would like to congratulate Reedsville High School. If you hadn't seen them, it's an awesome ball team. Very impressive. Also, to North Carolina State University
five games, not just five games in a row on successive night, but against really quality teams that they played, really excellent teams in an all-North Carolina final. So that was great. Tonight, if I may recognize another one of our outstanding staff members here at Rockingham County, right here in the governmental center, our HR director is Stephanie Kingston. And you've heard people talk about employee shortfalls, and we constantly need really good employees. And Stephanie has been right at the forefront of this. And I don't know the exact figures, but we went from a severe shortfall to pretty healthy at this present time. And I think it has a lot to do with Stephanie and her staff and how she manages that. So if you see Stephanie Kingston, she's doing us all a great service by providing quality employees to Rockingham County. That's all I have, sir.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Berger?
Yes, I too want to congratulate Coach Jason Ross and the Reedsville Rams. That is two boys' championships with several of the same kids, one in football, one in basketball. So congratulations to those young men. Then I just want to ask Lance to get us a report back on something. I hate that, you know, that we don't have folks present right now, but the last death in the jail was reported to me and I think some of the other commissioners as natural causes. The death certificate has come in, and it's actually an accidental death due to cocaine ingestion. And I know a few years ago we funded, it was over $100,000 for a body scanner. I think we just need a report back as far as what took place. I mean, it could have happened before that process. I just kind of think it's important for us to ask those questions.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Powell.
So I'd like to take the opportunity to recognize our elected leaders that were here. Of course, Sheriff Sam Page is here. We have Philip Butler with the school board and Paula Rakestraw also with the school board. I don't believe he's here anymore, but Gray Smith recently was promoted in the Sheriff's Department. I know he's the number two man, but I don't know what that position is actually called. But congratulations to him for his promotion. I'd also like to say, folks, that you know, all of our words have consequences, whatever we say. And it's not, we do not relinquish that when the political season comes upon us. It's not okay to go out and make baseless accusations against people. We're human beings, and we all are, and we deserve the opportunity to be questioned about our ideology or to be questioned about our votes, but not to mislead the public into thinking that, in particularly in this case, that we defunded the Sheriff's Department. We've done no such thing. As a matter of fact, since 2021, the Sheriff's Department, along with other county departments, have received more in raises than they did in the previous 9 years put together. We've increased the budget. A lot of that was to salary for the Sheriff's Department. Some of it was to equipment. We've done that with EMS. We've honored every request during the pandemic and post-pandemic that they have made to this board to preserve positions and to recruit and retain employees. And so we are in a position up here that we have to do for each department, and we can't always give to one over another because we don't have the money or there's rules or policies to follow. And sometimes I don't even understand them. That's why we have county staff. But at any rate, I can assure you that this board is as pro-law enforcement as any board that we've ever had. As a matter of fact, I think it was in 2021 that I proposed a resolution to honor law enforcement and not defund them back when that was a national thing to do, so to speak, and we're seeing a lot of attention placed on that. So we're going to continue to support the Sheriff's Department. We're going to continue to support our EMS and all of our county leadership as the best that we possibly can. We might not get it right every time, but we're going to try to get it right as much as we possibly can. So if you see videos or hear videos of people talking about us defunding the police, I can tell you that that is absolutely false. And in this particular case, we did buy the pistols. They've been bought, delivered, paid for, and they're carrying, they're in service at the Sheriff's Department now. So with that, Mr. Chairman, I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Berger?
Lance, I believe it's pretty easy to get some information, perhaps from the Association of County Commissioners or your manager association, to see how many cities and counties still offer those benefits that we're being accused of just cutting here.
Now, I know we had the manager's meeting with the ones in here in this county. The only one that's offering that now currently, I think, is Reidsville. All the other ones have cut it because of the overwhelming cost, but I can get information back about other counties.
Yes, sir.
Appreciate that.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Well, thanks to everyone for attending tonight. We appreciate it. Our next meeting will be April 1st at 6:30 here in the Governmental Center. So we look forward to you being here at that time. With that, we'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion.
Is there a second? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.